FTP is a famous conference that we are that we're doing. Earlier we scheduled for 7, 8 September, but thanks to the wonderful demand, we have postponed the conference to 24-25 January. And this talk nicely takes off from the last conversation we had with Manjula. When Manjula spoke about authentication and payments, and I think the issues that basically came up in the talk and is that I think authentication is such a complicated mess, and just to be able to even understand the different levels of fraud, we also need to understand, like, you know, what the problem is in the system. And I think we sort of left with this position, Manjula can correct me on that, is that the fundamental problem is how do you authenticate? What are the sources of authentication over here? And the technology is probably just a second level problem. It's not even a problem. So what we got to figure out is how do we, like, you know, solve this problem of authentication itself. And when I got introduced to Christian and what he was doing, I said that's a nice way to kind of take off from that conversation. I think great credit to her that she managed to kind of put down a very complicated talk into something that was still accessible. And I think at the end of it, we were still left with thinking, like, maybe we should call Manjula more often to, like, you know, talk more about this topic. But I'm glad she's here and Christian is here. I have just come back from a very dystopian kind of an event, so I'm going to let Christian introduce himself. We were at a music festival in Alsisar, and the interesting thing was that everybody, all the Kelawalas over there had set up credit card machines and they set up like ATM and all of that. And in spite of that, because there was just one cell phone tower and 3,000 people in the festival, we had such a hard time in doing transactions, and at various points now wondering, like, you know, are we going to get food over here today or not? So I think we're still coming out of that experience. But just briefly, Christian is going to talk to us about the system that's been created over here. And I'm expecting that there's going to be a good amount of questions for you that will follow. And I'm going to let you introduce yourself and take it forward from here. Thanks, Christian, for coming with
us. Thank you for the introduction. And thanks to Hasgeek for having me. Now, really bad self-introduction. So I'm, first of all, the GNU maintainer of GNU Talware. So GNU, as you all know, is the version of the free software movement, and GNU has lots of packages. I'm sure you all have GCC, GDB, and Emacs, and others. And so GNU Talware is another GNU package, and I'm the maintainer of that. And together with some of my colleagues, we're working at Inria, which is the National Institute for Research in Computer Science and Mathematics. We're developing GNU Talware there. Well, do I need to start with the motivation here? I'm not so sure. well, we like to have cash. Kind of necessary these days, still. Now, when you talked about the authentication question, one of the things is, do we really want to authenticate for cash? And I want to remind you of a little thing that happened in 1971, where they asked an American think tank, Rand Corporation is one of these big traditional American think tanks, suppose you were an advisor to the head of the KGB, the Soviet's secret police, right? So, which is usually not considered to be a very good and friendly organization for democratic countries. Suppose you're given the assignment of designing a system for the surveillance of all citizens and visitors within the boundaries of the USSR. Well, that's a bit old, right? The system must not be too obtrusive or obvious. What would be your decision? Do you know what the result was of the study?
Yes. Credit cards.
Credit cards, yes. They pretty much proposed the modern credit card system. Because, of course, if I do this, I know where you are and what you do. For pretty much anything that matters, right? Taking a cab, buying something, eating food, you know, whatever you do. Most of the things that will be with some of the tight economic activity. So, one claim would be to say master and Visa card are simply too transparent to really facilitate a democratic society in the first place. Now, as hackers, we all know about Bitcoin. Or who does not know about Bitcoin at all here? Yeah, exactly. Which is, in some sense, this proposal is saying, okay, we don't want this regulated system. We want to do something completely done by hackers. You know, this decentralized peer-to-peer system is done in free software, so it's very hard to stop this, right? Now, nobody's in control, nobody's in charge, it's just code. And this lack of regulation, the fact that there is nobody in charge, is one of the features this community always consistently advertises, right? There is no central bank, nobody will set interest rates, there can't be a Moody, right? Isn't that the slogan that the Bitcoiners would use here these days? You know, no possibility of demonetization, you know? Now, decentralized banking requires this Byzantine consensus where everybody agrees on what the balance is, and, you know, Bitcoin had this creative solution of tying initial accumulation, how to distribute money in the first place, to solving this Byzantine consensus problem through mining. Now, this proof of work computation is very expensive by design, and as a result, it's very expensive banking. Now, how expensive? Well, here's the historical chart of the transaction cost of Bitcoin. Now, how did we get to this chart? We look at how much it, we take one transaction, which comes with transaction fees, and of course, lots of transactions are put into a block, and then this block is mined, and the miner gets the reward from the transaction fees, plus the mining reward itself as new Bitcoins are being created. So we take the total number of Bitcoins being created, plus the transaction fees, and divide this by the number of transactions in the block. Multiply this by the current value of Bitcoin converted to US dollars. Make sense? That's the cost per transaction. And this is also how much energy a rational miner could invest into mining a block, which also means this is as much carbon dioxide as we're going to blow into the atmosphere for per transaction. Notice this here, it peaked at around $100. It's still around $5 per transaction. Now, $5 per transaction. So most of the things that you're really having problems with these days in India, if you pay $5 transaction fee, don't bother paying, right? It's ridiculous, right? I mean, you get your dinner for $5 or less, right? Usually much less. And so this is not going to work for most transactions like you do. In fact, if you look at the average size of transactions done with Bitcoin, they're typically transferring values of about $1,000 on average, right? Now, if I transfer $1,000 and paying, you know, $10 in fees, it might be okay, especially for global transfers where banks usually charge a lot. But this is not what we can run our economy on, at least not most of it. The other thing about Bitcoin is the cryptography is rather primitive. It's mostly, you know, hashes. And in particular, all Bitcoin transactions are public and linkable. Now, this has two implications. I do not have good privacy guarantees with Bitcoin. I have these accounts, which are hash keys, or public keys of my wallet, and somebody might be able to trace my transaction, because they're all public, anybody might in fact. On the other hand, as a government, I might not be able to, I might be unlucky. So as a citizen, I have no guarantees of privacy, and as a government, I have no guarantees of accountability. Right? It's just hard for both sides to get anything proper. Now of course, not having privacy guarantees meant there was research done on how to achieve privacy with it. And so if you look at Zerocoin, CryptoNote, and Zerocash, or Zcoin these days, they offer unlinkable transactions, which means both sides are perfectly anonymous when they do the transactions. Now, this comes at a cost, the transactions are even more expensive. And what we have to ask ourselves is, basically, is society ready for an anarchistic economy? You know, the one selling point Moody had for me was to say, well, I want to curb bribery, I want to curb corruption. Right? Most people would agree that that's usually a bad thing. Right. Now, with these kind of systems where nobody can trace anything, nobody can control anything, well, guess what? You know, corruption, crime, they love this. And in fact, they also can pay the high transaction fees. You know, if I sell, you know, highly dangerous illegal drugs, if I take bribes, I might be able to pay €100 transaction fee per transaction. Right? But if I want to buy my dinner, I won't. So they are not the answer. Of course, the answer is taller. And our goal was to really build a form of digital cash that is socially responsible. And I'll explain to you what I mean by that. So Taler actually is an acronym. It stands for Taxable Anonymous Secret Electronic Reserves. So I'm going to explain what all of these terms mean. But taxable, at a high level, means the government can see income. Whenever you receive money, be it because you're working or because you're selling something, the government should be able to see, okay, you received this amount of money. Right? So the government can make sure that you pay your taxes on it. On the other hand, when you spend money, when you give money at a store, when you pay for something, you can be anonymous. You never have to authenticate here. Which is very nice because we don't have this authentication problem. But it also helps with other things. And of course, it protects our civil liberties. Libre, because we're making this free software, shocking, and as an open standard, there's no patents on it, anybody can use it anywhere. And that's also important because this has to be a commons. If you transition your economy to use Visa or MasterCard, or what's this thing here, this common pay service? Okay, you've got a bunch of credit. Then if those companies take over, they can charge, you know, 1% fees, 5% fees, 10% fees. If you're locked into that, you'll pay whatever fees they have, right? And now if this is a foreign company, well, they can do to your economy whatever they want. They won't even be directly impacted. If it's an open standard based on free software, then you can run this with any number of competitors within your country. You don't have to worry about some foreign government saying, this is not illegal, we're not going to give you the license, we're going to charge you high fees, it not being out of your control. So if you want to have any kind of digital sovereignty as individuals, as well as a country, you want to make sure that your payment is based on a commons. Right? Just like in some sense, rupees were kind of a commons because at least the process was owned by the government. Right? If you go transition to a private economy, right, this will no longer be the case, and that is a very big fundamental change in terms of how independent you can live your lives. So that Libra is not just a small thing. And of course it's electronic, which means it's supposed to be practical and easy and all of that, and resource friendly, because we do not use expensive Google working calculations or anything like that. So what's the high level architecture? Well, we have a payment service provider, which we call the exchange. Now, the exchange does not convert between two different currencies. It's not like Bitcoin, a new currency. All it does, it takes your rupees that are in your bank account and converts them into rupees in your electronic wallet, or it takes rupees from an electronic wallet and converts them back to rupees in the bank account. Right? So it's really more like an ATM that can also take cash, right? Take cash out, put cash in. That's what the exchange does. You as a customer would go with your electronic wallet and withdraw coins with the help of the exchange provider. Once you have them in your wallet, you can spend the coins at a merchant. The merchant would then have to deposit them immediately at the exchange. He cannot act as a customer and spend them again. And because he has to deposit them at the exchange, which would put them into his bank account, the state can see, oh, you've got money. So it's not transitive on purpose. And finally, we have an auditing component, which makes sure the exchange operates correctly. That's required because what really happens is that, of course, the customer has some bank account. But he transfers the money from his bank account to the provider, in return gets the electronic tokens. And in the end, when the merchant deposits this, the exchange will send it to the bank account of the merchant. In the meantime, the exchange has the money in its bank account, and we need to make sure it doesn't run away with it. Right? And does it all properly. So the auditor will verify that the exchange does it correctly. Now, this is actually an electronic process. The exchange will have cryptographic proof that it operated correctly. It can show how much money it has to have in the bank, it can show that these are the outgoing transfers it had to make, and so on, so it can prove that it operated correctly. This is not, you know, some person looking at over somebody's shoulder. Okay, at this point I wanted to start with a demonstration of how the system works, because I think this is really important to understand what all the critical benefits are. So I turn away here now. Now I should say, you can all do this demo on your own computers anytime. This website is public. I have just installed a Chrome browser here without anything. So this is, you know, just like you can do it yourself. When you go to our demo page, the first step you have to do is you have to install the Tata wallet in your browser. So let's go to the installation page here. I have Chrome. I have to say, add the extension, confirm to the browser. It should be downloaded now. How fast is the networking in here today?
It's not because of the cycle.
Some fiber
got disrupted because of the cyclone.
Okay, it was working though. So this usually works a bit faster, but you know, the download is about 700 kilobytes, so it's not gigantic. Okay, so now I have it installed. And the first step is obviously I'm going to go to my bank. So here, we created effectively a fake bank for testing purposes, right? And so the first step for you would be to register at the bank to create a new account. We made this very simple. So now I've created myself a new bank account, right? And this is because it's a fake bank, you put in the currency kudos. So you should read this as rupees, right? Except we do not have the license to operate in India, right? And this is a very nice bank because it gives me a joining bonus of 100 kudos, so I have some money to start with, right? It's toy money. So, and here is the integration with Tata. And so my first step is going to be, obviously, to withdraw some kudos into my electronic wallet. So I'll say I would like to have 10 kudos. Now I have to select the payment service provider. And here the wallet then shows me what the fees are going to be. Because as with any payment system, there can be fees. payment service provider can set them at zero or whatever else he wants. In our case, we have of course set them to show that there could be fees. Right? So 0.2 kudos in fees, I can say, okay, that's fine, accept. Now we're back at the bank and we're doing the usual authentication step. I have not used Indian banks recently, but I'm sure you've had some kind of PIN 10 method here. Right? So we've implemented PIN 10 here in a very secure way. I'm sure everybody will appreciate the security of this. and now I have told the bank, I as the customer authorize the transfer, the 10 kudos have been taken out of my account and they'll be put into my wallet. So if I now click here, you see I've got 9.8 kudos in the wallet. All in all. Now I can log out. So at this point I could become anonymous, I could go over Tor, I can, you know, change my IP address, delete all the cookies, whatever, right? So this is no longer tied to my account, so people get this wrong and think it's still tied to my bank account. No, the bank from now on will no longer be able to distinguish this customer and this browser from any other of its customers. Right? Or rather the exchange service provider. They're all equal, all the coins are equal. So now what we have done is we have created a shop. Again, a nice little test shop. Here in this case we have an author who went a bit very commercial and he's trying to sell his book. And we have the usual teasers for the articles. We can say, okay, I would like to know why I should release free software to work at the university. And now it goes and says, well, you have to pay to read this article. Right? And so I can say, okay, I'm going to confirm the payment. And if I do confirm the payment, payment happens, and I get the article. This was the payment process. Okay? Notice this was real. There's a server in France. Was your network connection here from India, and it did the full payment, cryptographically secure. And as a user, you didn't see any crypto. Now I have to warn you, you're going to see the crypto later. Right? But for the users, our goal was that they should not have to deal with it. Now I can do some other fun things now. Like I can buy another article, I have to always do more than one payment. Very quickly, you can get the article. Now I can also say, okay, well, what happens if I already, you know, if I use this for buying newspaper articles? It's the web. I might navigate back to it, right? So let's go back to this 8 article that I bought first. It's one of these little things we expose. If a merchant comes at us and says, hey, pay for this article, we look, have I already paid for exactly this article? And if so, I just tell them, yes, I already paid, proof I already paid, and then they go, okay, and here's the article directly, and I don't have this interactive step. However, it is not possible for the merchant to figure out all of the things I bought. Right, they can only make me a proposal, and if I say, okay, exactly this proposal I already have, then I will just go ahead and show that I did it. Of course, it's an electronic wallet, so I have my balance, I can go in my transaction history and see what other various things I have bought, right? But this is all on my computer. If I delete my wallet, it will be gone. If I lose my computer, my money is gone. Now I can make backups. Right? So right now, not very easily, but in principle, there's no problem making backups. Right? So, and if you want to see what it really looks like, there's this show database function here, which shows you the crazy, you know, crypto coins and everything that is actually stored on the computer. Do you have any questions about the demo?
Yes. When you say Taylor knows who knows that you bought the paper that you paid.
Your wallet knows, yeah.
Oh, the wallet knows.
Mm-hmm.
But also the exchange knows.
The exchange.
No. The exchange does not. The exchange does not know who bought what. And they also never know what was bought. The exchange never gets the contracts. The exchange only is being told this amount plus banking address of the merchant plus hash of the contract.
Okay.
And so if the government wants to do an audit, they can say, okay, dear merchant, you received 50 cents for hash of this contract. Now please show me what the hash of the contract is. That's what the government would do in a tax audit. So the payment service provider has no idea. All he sees is, I have to send 5 euros to this guy. I have to send 20 rupees to this guy. I have electronic proof, I have to do this. But that's all I know. It's really data minimization. It's privacy by design. Nobody gets any information they don't absolutely need. Right? So the payment service provider knows when you withdraw money, because obviously, you know, it has to come out of your account. Right? And so you can say how much money you withdrew. You cannot say how much money you've got left on your computer. You, of course, can say how much you withdrew, where you spent it, what you spent it for. However, you do not ever get the account details of the merchant. You get the cash of that and solved it, so it can't be brute force. Yes?
Can you please show a demo wherein you transfer kudos from Hasgeek to my account or from my
account? You would have to set up a merchant.
Okay, right now I'm only registered as a user.
Yes.
So am I registered as a merchant or a...
If you created a bank account, you can use this for both in the demo. But you have to, because we currently only have the website, you have to, the web version, you have to create some kind of website where you have done the merchant integration. Where you have configured your bank account to tell it to the shop and offer me a web page where I can go and pay. Now we have a tutorial for how to do this on our web page. So if I... If you want to figure out how to do this on the merchants, at the very bottom, there's manuals for merchants. And one will tell you system administrator how to set up the payment backend, and the other one will tell you for how to do the front end integration with your web shop. It's pretty easy, I'm going to go about some of these details later, but if you want to do this and receive money, you can do it. And if you are happy with kudos, you can do it against our current running demonstrator. Yes.
I'm a little confused here. What I want to understand is that who owns the exchange and who owns the wallet? So you want to say this is an API or is it, it's an SDK which we can integrate in our own. Suppose I want to start a wallet company tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
So I can integrate Teller into my...
Teller is a couple of things. Okay. Teller is a protocol that we have defined, and there's a web page I'm going to show later with the detailed specification. So that's the open standard. Anybody can see how it's supposed to work. Mm-hmm. So Thaler, as a GNU package, is also a free software reference implementation where we give you this wallet, where we give you examples for how to run a merchant, where we give you an exchange service provider, and where we're working on giving you an auditor component. Right? Now, if you want to go and write your own wallet or write your own merchant integration, we would ask you to please try to make it free software. But, of course, we have no control over that. And as long as you abide by the protocol, you can just do it. Right? And for running an exchange, you basically usually will need the permission of the government for two reasons. One of the governments usually you want to tie to existing banks, and they will not let you do this without permission. And secondly, if the government gives you permission and says, we are auditing you, just like all the banks are being audited, that's the reason why people will trust you to bring the bank you their money, because they believe that if the government audits the bank is not going to be so likely to go bankrupt. Hi, Lehman Brothers. Right? And in this case, of course, if the auditor is run correctly, the provider cannot go bankrupt. But still, you want to convince your users that you can't go bankrupt, which means you have to have an auditor, which typically means that you involve the government.
Do you mean to say that Thaler cannot be used in India as long as the government doesn't agree to run the exchange for it?
The government doesn't have to run the exchange. The government doesn't have to run the bank. But it has to give you permission to do so.
Okay.
Because as you integrate with the banking system, they can find who you are. And usually that ends up badly if you do this kind of thing without permission.
Mm-hmm.
In Germany and the US, the jail sentences are many, many years. I suspect in India it's not going to be any different. So yes, you have to have this permission. On the other hand, people tell me that in India, getting permission to an electronic payment system isn't that hard these days.
Yeah, you know, payment banks and correspondent banks, and they're not very hard to run.
Hmm?
There are two different licenses for this one, the payments bank and correspondent bank.
Yeah, this is not a correspondent bank.
Because correspondent banks let you withdraw money on behalf of your government. They need to operate like an ATM.
Okay, well then maybe this is like that, yes.
That's right, yeah.
Okay, let's go back to the presentation. Again, you can look at it. Also, all the code for these websites is all in public GitHub repositories, right? So what's the value proposition? For the customer, you pay with one click. Compare this to verified by Visa and Cry, right? You never have to be feared by being rejected by false positive and fraud detection. when I swipe my credit card to India, it's always, you know, double the heartbeats. Because what if it says, hey, you in India, what are you doing there? Right? Rejected. And then, you know, I run out of credit cards, run out of cash, and then what do I do? But here, the money's in your wallet. You have proof that this is your money. There's not going to be any fraud detection. The only fraud detection happens is that if your wallet tries to double spend, it will reject it. But as long as you didn't hack your wallet software, it can't happen. It's secure like cash, except of course you don't have counterfeit. I know in India that used to be a big problem, the 2,000 rupee bills are a bit better these days, but here, you know, if you are able to counterfeit this, you can break all of the other cryptographic protocols in India pretty much. I have my privacy, nobody can trace me, nobody knows where I'm going. Right? So, this will allow me to, say, donate to political parties, to buy news articles that may not be agreeing with the government, to travel where I want to travel without people knowing who I'm meeting. Right? It's stable because we do not introduce a new currency. So as you know, Bitcoin, you have these huge currency fluctuations. Here, you can pay in rupees, in euro, in dollar, or in Bitcoin, whatever is typical for your transaction. And it's free software, so you don't have to worry about this thing doing more than it should. For the merchants, again, the transactions are really fast, which means your customers won't be so annoyed, right? Or won't abort in the middle. You get in the end signed contracts, you have electronic proofs of what happens, you're sure that no legitimate customer will be burned by saying, oh, I can't do the transaction. Because it's free software, there should be competition and fair pricing, as opposed to if you go for a monopoly like Apple Pay or Google Pay, which can then gouge you whatever they want. The protocol itself is also, of course, very efficient, and there's no possibility of fraud, so you have no costs. You can pay any currency. Of course, the currency has to match between customer and merchant, or some banking service has to do the exchange. We do not do the conversion between euros and dollars. Right? But in principle, the system can pay in any currency, in any amount. Again, you as a merchant also want to have no fluctuation risk. And of course, since it's unsuitable for illegal business, that's also a good thing for your reputation. You won't be in the same corner as the drug dealers and human traffickers, right? And finally, for Europeans, it's good because it actually complies with European regulation. In Europe soon, people will require to implement privacy by design data minimization by law. And I'm very curious to see how other payment service providers are going to realize those requirements. Well, the government, as I mentioned before, free software, preserve independence, taxability, no black markets, no tax evasion. So these are the key goals these days that I would support in general for the demonetization in India. It's highly efficient, which means lower transaction costs is like a reduced bet that's good for the economy. You have signed contracts, no counterfeit problems. You won't have bad banks because you can audit the providers automatically. And even for the governments, the privacy can be an advantage because there is such a thing like industrial espionage. Right? There are people that want to figure out where profits are being made, what your supply chain is like. And if you can hide one half of the transactions, this kind of espionage will be harder. We know the NSA hacked Swift. If you, Swift is this big international exchange. We know, of course, that they will look at MasterCard and Visa card traffic. In fact, I knew in 2003 that they were looking at in-game trades of coins to trace money laundering. So, having a way that this makes it very hard, because except for the customer, really nobody knows, and it's on the customer's computer, right? It's very good to protect against espionage. Now, before we go into the technology, I have to give you a more precise definition of what we mean by taxability. So we say it's taxable because, as I mentioned before, the income of a merchant is visible from his deposits. Right? When you get the coin, you have to deposit it. At that point, you have to say who you are and which bank account you should go. And that means the governments can see what you want. The hash of the contract is part of what was has to be given the deposit data, which means later the government could come to you and say, what did you sell here? Right? Was it bicycles? Was it computers? Was it drugs? If it's drugs, you probably go to jail. And therefore, the state can trace your income, can say, well, this was income, this was sales, and apply the right tax code. Now, they might do this probabilistically. They don't have to do this for every transaction. They might say, every X years, we pick this someone at random, I'm going to go to you, check that you paid the right amount of taxes, I'm just going to go through your transactions that year, and see if you sent the total right taxation to the government. And then for the rest of the time, they may never know what happened at all. And that's fine.
So all the government knows is what the merchant sold and for how much?
Yeah, but not necessarily to whom. Now, of course, this is just what the payment system provides. If the government says, you are allowed to sell guns, but only if you verify the identity of the buyer. Right? Then you just add the identity of the buyer into the contract based on whatever verification protocol the government prescribed to you, right? And then the government can see who bought the gun, right? But in general, for most purchases, the government would be insane to require you to do a strong identity check. We would hope it doesn't do that. We would hope it follows data minimization, right? And then if you buy your chewing gum, you know, you don't have to prove identity with fingerprint and iris scanner first.
So the key thing I'm taking away is the data minimization part. It's,
yes.
It's the, so the entities that you laid out in the beginning of your talk, right? So how much information the merchant needs, how much information the exchange needs, how much information the consumer needs.
Yes.
You get the bare minimum.
Yes, you get the bare minimum, and everything else that can be added is voluntary. I, as the customer, can, of course, disclose proof that I bought this to another party. I could disclose this proof and go to court and say, hey, give me my car, I paid for it. So I have the proof, right? Just like you as the merchant have the proof that I paid and that you should go to the exchange and say you have to send me my money, right? But you as the merchant also have the contract. Now you don't give it to the exchange usually, but the state could of course compel you to do so, right? So everybody has the information that they naturally minimally have and need, and everything else is voluntary and not required by the payment system. Okay? So these are the key things for taxability, but there are some limitations. We call them loopholes. So that's the withdrawal loophole. When I go to the bank at the ATM and want to withdraw cash, just to take the normal thing, I can put in my credit card and my PIN code, and then you can go there and take the cash out. Right? I authenticated you take the money. The same applies here. If I log into my bank site, say withdraw things on your computer with your wallet, you have it in your computer.
Sorry, can you see that again?
If I go to the bank site using your computer, log in with my password on your computer, allow you with your wallet to withdraw cash onto your computer using my account, well, guess what? Then you receive money and the system will think that I got it. Right? So if I give permission at the time of withdrawal, right, then it could go to somebody else. That's the withdrawal report. That's pretty much impossible to prevent for any kind of payment system. As at the normal ATM, I can put in my credit card and you take the cash out. You're sure it's not counterfeit, you got it, and everybody will think it was me. Right? But it requires my collaboration at the time of withdrawal. The second one is a bit more subtle, which is, of course, I can share my wallet with others. Once I have withdrawn coins, I can give you a copy of my wallet. Now, this is not giving you the same as allowing you to withdraw it, because now we both have the money. Right? It's just data. Computers are very good at copying. Now what happens at this point is that either of us can spend the money, but whoever spends it first wins, and the second person loses. And of course I cannot really prove to you that I deleted it from my computer, right? Even if you see me type in the RM command, I might have made a backup earlier, right? So here, this is, if I share like this, the wallet state, that's between like family and friends. If we trust each other, right, if you're my wife, if you're my spouse, if you're my kid who gets pocket change, I might transfer money to you that way. If this is a business transaction, or I'm really buying something and the store has to go, well, he may give me the money, or he might spend it at another store, he may have already spent it at another store, right? He may be spending it at hundreds of stores and I might not get anything. Well, they will not like this. They will not like you just copy over the coin.
But isn't right? That also a loophole for avoiding taxation?
Yes, but what we say is, we distinguish between transaction and transfer, or what we call sharing. Right? So we say sharing doesn't have to be taxable. When I share within my family money, if I have a joint account for my family, transfers between me and my family members, right? If I buy my friend a drink, that doesn't have to be taxable. Right? If it's a mutually exclusive transfer of value, I give you the money and I no longer have it, that is a transaction that we want to have taxable. Right?
Yeah, but if you share the wallet with the merchant,
mm-hmm.
That's how black money gets found.
No, because the merchant can't be sure that he actually got it. I might bribe five politicians just to save 50
assuming there is that trust between merchant and the buyer.
If there is that much trust, we say it's okay that it's not taxable, because then it's really a family thing.
No, not really.
Or friends.
It's just like what happens in a regular store here. You ask for, you show the credit card, it says 2% more. And then you pay again.
Yeah, that's a good point, right? I mean,
essentially the merchant is saying, hey, give me the cash. Like,
this is bypassing the exchange.
Yes, but he has to trust the doctor to spend it somewhere else. That's the point. Because you're not giving it to me, you're just giving him a copy. Right?
Yeah,
you can do this at multiple merchants, and in the end, he's out the money.
But he
he's taking a high risk. He's taking the risk that he got nothing. Right? That's the point. If you're that close that the guy is willing to take the risk that he got nothing.
No,
right?
You save the tax.
No, but he may get nothing. He may save the 5% tax, but he may have gotten zero.
Okay.
Because I might have given the money to somebody else the same way, or I might have spent the money the regular way and given him just an old copy of an old coin that was already worthless.
So, what if you have a black exchange?
That's the point. Nobody would trust the black exchange because the exchange can run away with your money if it's not audited.
It's licensed by the government.
Yeah.
That's insane.
So, how do you prevent other spending? Just exchange?
Online detection. When you go to the merchant, you give him the payment, the merchant goes immediately to the exchange, deposits the money, the exchange comes back to the merchant, says, this was spent the first time, and then the merchant says the payment was successful.
No, I actually meant if there's
always the same exchange.
No, there can be many exchanges, but the customer picks which one he likes. So when you withdraw, you pick your exchange.
Also, the merchant verifies with your exchange.
Verifies with the exchange of that the customer had. The exchange is tied to the coin. Now, what the merchant can say, I only accept exchanges that are audited by these auditors, and that have fees that aren't high. I'm willing to only pay fees up to this amount. If the fees are higher, you have to cover them. So these things, so the merchant can impose constraints on the payment process, but he doesn't get to select the exchange. So it's like he also picks the currency usually when he makes the proposal, right?
Okay, now I was thinking of the existence of an exchange in Ukraine or something for Indian transactions. So this sort of friendly neighborhood transaction, they both agree to use that exchange. Essentially,
the choice of the exchange makes no difference here. The friendly discussion, the friendly exchange here happens without the exchange. That's the point. I just copy my
point is, if the friendly exchange happened without the exchange, then what would happen between this merchant and this buyer would be that the merchant wouldn't be entirely sure that they actually had the money to give.
Yes.
And if there were a black exchange sitting in the Ukraine, these guys would validate against the black exchange, proceeding to give money to each other, and it would effectively be non-taxable. So
it's a licensed exchange.
I'm not sure. The point is, the merchant could, against the black exchange, maybe ask, has this coin been spent?
Yeah.
But 5 milliseconds later, that merchant, yeah, it wasn't spent yet. 5 milliseconds later, it might be spent.
Yeah.
Right? So without having this agreement from the exchange, and you are it, you are the one who's going to get the money, you may get nothing. Right? Okay?
Yep. The whole sharing process works on how fast the exchange is.
No.
If there's a
sharing
delay,
does not involve the exchange.
If there's a delay in the extension, there might be multiple transactions, right?
If there's a delay?
Yeah, if there's a delay between the first transaction and the second transaction, the wrong transaction might go through.
No, because the merchant will only say this transaction was successful after he got the confirmation from the exchange. So if you spend your money twice, right, one of the two will come faster to the exchange. The exchange will let the first one say, okay, this is it. The second one will say a double spend. Then it comes back, and one of the merchants will say it was successful, the other one was not. But if you share the coin, you cannot be sure that you are going to be the one who wins the race. If you are the original owner, right, then you know that when you spend it the first time, it will be good. Right? And so sharing only works if you can really trust the other party, ultimately not have spent the money already.
Confirmation of payment from the wallet via the exchange, you know, is it only done after you get the confirmation from the exchange? So you spend and the internet connectivity is there.
Yeah.
So, and you have spent. So that's okay. But if somehow there is no connectivity and the wallet has money.
This is an online payment system. You can only spend money if you're online.
Right.
Okay.
Am I spending money as coins or am I spending money from my wallet?
You're spending your money as coins from your wallet.
So, no, for example, if I'm sharing it with my friends
mm-hmm.
and family, and both of us are trying to do a payment,
mm-hmm.
So for example, if I initiate a payment, will it go through with a specific coin that I'm using, or will it go through as being initiated from a particular wallet?
No, it would just use a coin. The wallet itself is just a piece of software, it doesn't involve the protocol. The wallet has no identifier.
In that case, if I give out a coin to my family, how would they be notified in case I've already spent it?
if you want to really give a coin to your family, you have to just delete it from your wallet locally, I would say. Right? Then you have given it to them.
Okay.
Otherwise, you risk that both of you try to spend it and one of them goes gets an error.
So you're not really sharing a wallet, you're just transferring.
Yes. Now, you might, of course, share a wallet by having a synchronization service that keeps them both in sync all the time, which is what you might do if you have multiple devices. Okay? So, let's look a bit at how it works. So, first of all, we decided that we will expose one bit of information to websites, namely, is the Talab wallet present in the browser or not? Right. This is so that the website can say, here, enable the Talab payment option if it's there, not show it if it's not supported by the user. And simple ways, you use our shared library, and then you can do your JavaScript Talab on present to do something, or Talab on absent to do something else, and thereby say activate elements or deactivate elements in your web page depending on Talab being present or not. You can also do all of the interactions, I should mention, including payment, and this without JavaScript being enabled at all. Browser. Here you would use this using CSS, where you can say, CSS visible if Tyler is there, invisible if Tyler is not there, and also the rest of the payment all works without even JavaScript and being enabled in the browser for websites. Now, how do you do a payment? Well, basically, once you've built the shopping cart, you kind of know what the user wants. When the user clicks, go buy it, you send a response back, HTTP 402 payment required. Who has seen the status code before? But in the spec forever.
Yes.
First time you see it used, yes. 402 of all places, right? It's below 403. So, and in our case, what we just have to send ex-Tala contract URL some address where the wallet can fetch the contract. Right? And then what you do is you send the normal body that you would send for credit card payments. So if the browser does not have Tala installed, well, the user will get this. And this line will be ignored. And in fact, the 402 status code is pretty much just read like 200, okay, here's render the body. Right? If Tala wallet is installed, 402, wallet goes up, that's my signal, grabs this thing, fetches the contract, shows the contract to the user, and allows him to access the payment next. So this is how the payment starts. Very easy there. What does the contract look like? Well, this is a bit messy. So, we have things like, what's the payment amount? Who are the acceptable auditors? What are possible rules for the exchange? How long is the offer valid? The fulfillment URL says, once the user says, I want to buy this thing, where do you go? Right? Or when he clicks in the history, where do you go? What is the fee structure that's allowed? What's your address? What's the public key of the merchant? What is actually being bought? Right? How long can you get refunds? And so on. Right. We have a long specification of possible fields, and if you find something's missing, please let us know. But this is just basically a JSON specification of what the deal is. Okay. Now, I should mention, after you go to the fulfillment URL, what basically happens is the browser goes there, you say again, hey, payment required, the browser will post to you the coins. You pass the coins to the exchange, you just pass them through basically what you get from the browser. The payment source provider tells you 200 okay, payment successful, or error code. If payment was successful, you give them the page. If payment failed, you give the error message back to the wallet. Alright, so it's pretty simple afterwards, even that. Now, let me explain to you now how the mathematics works.
Just a reminder.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where exactly are the coins posted on that URL?
Can I recommend doing the demo game to complete the scheming? So that
no. You can do this at the end,
sure.
Because this is a recording, and I don't want people to look at the recording and say what I said. So, basically, if you in the fulfillment URL, when you go there the first time, then you get a payment required again, and there it says what the address is where the coins have been posted.
Oh, the X,
yeah. Exactly. If you look at the space paper, it's on my webpage, all of these things are also described in detail. Okay, now for the crypto.
This is where the thing we broke.
No, that's in the first use. Look at the years. These are the years when the primitives we are using, the things we're combining, were pretty much first in the literature. So unlike some of the other payment systems, you'll see that they are rather ancient. Which means we have been studying them for 40 years. And they haven't really been broken for 40 years. Now, of course, we don't use MD4 as the cryptographic hash function, but SHA-512. But if you think you can break SHA 512, well, go for it, you know? Right? Blind signatures based on RSA, say 2048, you know? Break that. If Thaler is the only thing that falls, I'd be very surprised. Right? Digital signatures, same thing. Diffie-Hellman key exchange, using elliptic curves on curve 25519, you know, please go for it. You know, there's lots of really, really good prizes waiting for you if you break any of these. Right? And this is in contrast to some of the other things that have been proposed, like Zcash, where the constructions are like 1, 2, or 3 years old, and in the last year have suddenly lost, you know, 15%, 20% of its strength because of a new attack coming out against them. Right? So these are really time-tested constructions. And I will explain to you how they're being combined, so you can in the end say if you want to, you know, go ahead, break them. Okay. First of all, I know it says elliptic curve on the slide. Do not panic. You all know what a curve is, right? Set of points in a 2D space. And so we can understand that there are points on a curve, right? And so, suppose we're given some curve, made up by some crazy mathematician. Then we can pick a point on that curve and say that's the generator G. Okay? Just pick one that has a particular property. And if I have an elliptic curve, it's a group, which has a group operation in the addition, which means I can take two points and add them to each other, and I get another point. Now the addition law is pretty much you draw a line between the two points, there will be a third point where it meets on the curve, you take the complement of that, get another point on the curve, and that's the result of the addition. But you don't have to understand how two points are being added. Just, you know, I have a point, another point, I can add the two up. Right? And I'll get a third point. Always. Okay? So, which means if I have g plus g, I can call this 2g. Right? And if I then 2a add another times g, I have 3g. Right? Which also, of course, means if I pick some scalar, some number, you know, 5, 10, 50, 50 billion, times d, I can do multiplication with a scalar. Okay? Everybody with me so far? You know, from addition to multiplication is pretty easy. Now, it turns out, for these elliptic curves, they are a group, which means if I do this O times, where O is defined as the group order in some prime number, O times plus 1, I'm back at g. It rolls around. It's like modulo, right? Everybody here so far? Those are the key properties. Now, there's one more thing, which is, if I give you some C for a sufficient large elliptic curve, big C, some point, and I ask you, what's the small c? What's the factor against this generator? Basically, you want to do C divided by G, right? Well, there's no efficient way for you to do that. You know, to really more or less try a lot, and given the elliptic curve, the, you know, we use fields of 2 to the 250 something, or O for the group size, you know, it is infeasible for you with current mathematics using the energy of this universe to do this. Right? So, if again, if you can break this, you know, people have been studying this for 50 years, you know, please get your fields local. Whatever, right? So, that's pretty much all you know about elliptic curves. So.
But why do the other so-called weaker wallets don't use that?
I would not say that they don't use that. I mean, it depends on what kind of wallet you have. But we don't just use them. We use lots of other things. Right? And just giving you this as one little bit of background before we go into the real thing. Okay?
Okay.
Elliptic curve is part of the Diffie-Hellman, which is basically HTTPS underlying mechanism.
Well, Diffie-Hellman can work on, you know, exponentiation with more like RSA does. Or it can use elliptic curves. So for the elliptic curve, Diffie-Hellman, we use this, for example, yes. So that will be a Diffie-Hellman later, yes. Okay, but first of all, I should mention, you will now see a crazy number of public-private key pairs. And I'm only showing you a subset of the number of public-private key pairs in the system to kind of focus on the important ones. Right, so this is, okay. So, first of all, in the setup phase, when we are the exchange provider, we're going to create an RSA key pair, right? So, if you like the mathematics, look on the left, right? If you like pictures, look on the right, okay? So this is, I always give the full math, right? Which means, of course, if you understand, you know, that, you know, this works out in the end, fine if you don't. Well, first, trust us, the math is pretty simple.
Torsion.
Yeah, yeah, so that's a torsion function, yes. And this is, by the way, it's a really canonical RSA at this point. But let me try to stick to the pictures for the explanation. So, we roll some dice, generate some numbers P and Q. From those numbers, we're going to derive the seal, which is like the public key, something saying, this is a valid coin later, right? And a hammer, that's the private key. And we can use the private key to apply the seal to something, right? It's just minting, boom, 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 right? Signing, right? So the hammer is what we use for signing, the seal is what everybody knows, this is a valid thing, right? It's just like the printing press for making new rupees, right? Everybody knows what it looks like, but only a few people have the, well, hopefully only a few people have the hammer. Okay, now, second thing, set up, as a merchant, I have to create myself a public private key pair for signing contracts. So I'll pick a random M, small number, and multiply this by G, I get my big M. Now what does this mean? I now have the capability, small m, to do digital signature using the T-curve signature schemes, which pretty much looks like this. This is, you know, proof signed by M. And everybody can see that was signed by this merchant, as long as he keeps the small m secret, only he can do this. Okay? As the customer, when I want to withdraw coins, first thing I do, well, I throw my dice, generate a small c, and calculate the big C, and here I visualize the big C by putting the actual public key on the rim. So it's a unique thing. You know, the C's are so large that if two people really do generate a random number, there is no chance that there will be a collision by accident. Right? It just will not happen. You're more likely to die by meteor strike and lightning at the same time as the, you know, sun goes supernova or something. What?
But we were just
struck
by a
PM anyway. Yeah. So, now, given this, well, first of all, we have this plan sheet, and we have the capability for the small c to apply a seal with the coin. Right? You know, sign. This coin approves. Notice when we sign contracts, we don't sign them as the customer, we will sign them with the coins. And since they are our coins, signing with the coins is I accept and hereby I pay at the same time. Okay, now I need to withdraw. So again, I'm going to throw up and generate a random B. And I'm going to use that to mask the planchet. I'm going to put the planchet effectively into an envelope signed as locked by B. So without knowing small b, you can't open this envelope. That's one of the key concepts of blind signatures. So it's in this envelope is somehow my planchet. And I'm going to set this to the exchange. And the exchange takes its hammer and hammers on the envelope, right? And sends the result back to the customer. Of course, when I do this transmission, I tell the exchange, I am this customer, please sign this coin and deduct the respective amount for my thing and so on. But we don't have to show that. That's implied, right? And then, well, since I have small b, I can open the envelope and get out the signed coin, right? So basically, the hammer applies through the envelope onto the coin, mathematically. Okay? Which now means this is a real coin. No longer a planchet, now it has value. Right? Because it has been signed by the exchange provider as a real one. Okay? On the other hand, the exchange does not know the specific serial number, the public key that's on the coin. It could not open the envelope. Right? Which means when I spend it, it is not tied to me, to my identity. Okay? So, you look at the demo, how does this work again? Well, here's your bank, you authenticate against your bank, you say, I would like to withdraw a certain amount. The wallet is going to go to the Tata exchange and say, hey, what kind of coins do you have available? What kind of denominations? What are the fees? Gets those. User says, okay. Then you execute the withdrawal from the bank. The bank might say, hey, you need to prove to me who you are, authenticate please, whatever. You know, says, okay, you withdraw the coins, sends the money to the provider. Your wallet goes to the provider and says, hey, I want to get my coin. Here's your coin. Unblinding, thank you, I've got my coins. Right? Let's go shopping. Shopping, of course, initially means that I find myself some merchant and someone negotiate with him some terms. Some proposal of what we might want to do. Then what happens is we have this proposal, it's called a deed, and the merchant will go and sign it saying, this is an offer. First negotiate something, it can be very simple, it's just a click on the respective link, right? But the merchant first starts and says, I offer you this under these terms. Sign the merchant. Sends this to the customer. That's the 402. Right? Then as the customer, well, I take my small c, say, signed. Now, of course, if one c is enough, I might apply multiple coins for details. Signed the coin, and I send it together with the real coin to the merchant. The merchant says, hey, this is a real coin. Right? If so, he passes it on to the exchange, and the exchange says, hey, this is one of mine. Does the same check. Says, well, then it looks, hey, have I seen this coin before? Database lookup? No, I haven't. Valid? Yes, I have. Oh, let me send you the old signature. By the way, it's a hash of the contract here. Send me the old signature as proof that it's double spent. Or I send you a message saying, yes, it's okay. You know, payment accepted. And then we know, payment went through, merchant delivers an article, everybody's happy. Now, again, how does it look like in the browser? You know, you negotiate what you want, you select possible Tala payment method, you tell your wallet, yes, I like this, you navigate to the fulfillment URL, the merchant says, hey, this is the, please pay. You send the payment, the merchant forwards to Tala exchange, the Tala exchange confirms the payments, you confirm the payment from the wallet, the browser reloads the fulfillment URL, you send the correct resource back that the user bought, or just a confirmation page with your shipment is on the way or whatever. Okay. Any questions about the process here? Okay. Small problems. Except for the nice web integration, all of this was actually known 25 years ago, and then patented, and therefore not usable for a while, for free software. But one problem was always there, which is, if I want to pay for 100 euros, or probably 1 lakh, right? If I use 1 rupee coins, that's an awful lot of signing still. Each of these individual crypto operations is like a millisecond, very fast. But if I have to do 10,000 of these, or 50,000 of these, oh my god, right? On the other hand, if I withdraw, say, 10,000 rupee coin, or actually 2,000 rupee coin, this is the modern thing, right? And I want to pay 100 rupee bill with it, and the system comes back, well, you can't, it's a 2,000 rupee thing, not so good, right? So, I don't want to have, you know, billions of 1 rupee coins, and I do not want to have a situation where the customer has enough rupees in his wallet. He has 2,000 rupees, but he can't spend them. You know, I got caught by lunch this way. Here's 2,000 rupees. Caught. Great. So unless you like that situation, we have to have a way to give what you would call change. Right? And we can't, of course, as a wallet, we don't know what the user is going to spend, so we can't withdraw the exact change. We never want to be in a situation where I have, you know, enough money in total, but not the right change. Now, there are two other goals we have. When we do this with change, we want to maintain unlinkability, which means if I use my money and spend it once to have something sent to my home, and therefore I have disclosed my identity to the merchant, that could be okay. Now, if I use the same thing to serve to some subversive website where I lead some, you know, hostile government political propaganda, right? And they say, hey, this was the same guy because he used the same coin. I can link the two transactions. It was the change from this other transaction. Well, I might find myself in jail in a really bad situation. So we need them to be unlinkable still. Even if I'm using the change from one transaction, the next transaction, nobody should be able to say this was the same guy. It's coming from the same wallet, right? So that's unlinkability. Secondly, you also want to maintain taxability, which means that if I get change from a transaction with a merchant, I shouldn't be that I didn't get the change, but somebody else got the change. Right? I do the transaction, there's change happening, and somebody else gets it. Then that would be income, right? That then he might not have to tax. And I can't tax the change, because if it's really just change that goes to me, well, that's certainly not something I want to have pay income tax on change, right? So I have to have this tricky situation that I have to make sure the change goes to the same person that it had possibly before, and that it's unlinkable to the old transaction. Two equals. How do we do this? Well, first of all, in the contract that I sign with my coin, I can specify, hey, I'm signing this with a 500 rupee coin, but it's only worth 100 rupees, which means the coin still has 400 rupees worth. Right? That's very easy. And the exchange will only pay the merchant the 100 rupees. And remember in the database, the coin wasn't fully spent, but partially spent, there is some value left. Very easy to do for any amount. And then what we can do is, I can go ask the wallet and say, hey, I own this coin. I don't tell you who I am, I own this coin. Right? Please give me change for the remaining value of the coin. Right? There's 400 rupees left, please give me 400 rupee coins in return. Right, that's the high-level idea. So let me tell you a solution that does work first. So when I try to get this changed, what could I do is, well, I just make myself a new planchet. I make myself a new blinding factor, put them into an envelope, ask the exchange to sign it. Right? And I authenticate not with my normal account, but with the old coin, saying, this old coin compels your exchange to give me change. Why does this not work? Well, because this new coin may not be mine. I could have him generate these two things, send me the envelope, and I take the envelope, sign it with my old coin, say, hey, exchange, please give me change. Exchange signs the coins, and I give him the signatures. And since I never had seen you, but he does, he is now has exclusive control over the new coin, right? Which means he had income, and everybody thought it was change. Right? This is why this does not work. Is that clear? So how do we fix it? First of all, we need Diffie-Hellman. So Diffie-Hellman, for those who haven't seen it, is basically I can have two numbers, that is D and H, which are private keys, and they have the corresponding public keys. And I can compute from this the Diffie-Hellman of the two. And the interesting thing is I can compute the Diffie-Hellman if I have both the private keys, or one of the private keys and one of the public keys. Right? Now if you look at the math, it's stunningly simple, right? Capital D is DG, capital H is HG, and multiplication is commutative. The end. Right? So, with either of the private keys and one of the public keys, or both of the private keys, I can compute this. And of course, I can use this, is a big number, again as an input for generating other secret numbers, like private keys. So, what do we do? I have my old private key for my old coin that I want to get changed for, and I just make up a new number T. We call it a transfer key. Compute the Diffie-Hellman of the two, and from the Diffie-Hellman, I derive two other secret inputs, the new key coin and the blinding factor, and I can derive the envelope from that, and I will send that to the exchange. Okay? Now, first problem here is if I do this, from the exchange point of view, this does not look any different than the straw man solution, right? I sent an envelope to the exchange. So that's not going to give me anything because I can't guarantee this construction. So what I first have to do is I have to do the construction three times. Like this, right? I just use three T values, right? And generate three envelopes. And now, the exchange is going to pick two of the three for me to demonstrate that this was well formed. It's cut and choose protocol. So basically, if I cheat with a chance of 66%, the exchange will say, you cheated and keep my money. And if I was honest, and the tax rate was less than two-thirds, you know, then it's all good. The tax rate is more than two-thirds, so we have to do more than three. Okay, so the exchange says, picks one of them at random, right? And then what I have to do is I have to send the T values, the small T values of the ones that wasn't picked to the exchange. The exchange can now take the old public key of the coin, the public key, and the T1, also to the Diffie-Hellman, and compute the envelopes. If that worked for two randomly chosen out of the three, the exchange will believe that the third one was well formed as well. Right? Now, no guarantee, But of course, you have the guarantee of two in three of being caught. And if being caught means you lose all of your money, economically it doesn't make sense to cheat unless the, you know, penalty of taxation is more than two-thirds. Yes?
So is three is just in your example, or is that the implementation?
Three is also the implementation, because there are very few tax systems, but more than two-thirds are the taxes. And of course, then the cost goes up.
So this is a very expensive check? Why don't you
set
the number to like 10,000 or something?
Well, then it gets expensive.
Okay.
But because, of course, you have to do some cryptography here each time, and you have to have the bandwidth for it. So with three, it's pretty cheap. Right? But with 10,000, it would start to get very expensive. And there's no real reason. You know, because 10,000 versus 100, it means your taxation rate from 99% to 99.999%.
But this is exponential, isn't it? So like 20 or something, what do you mean 99%?
No, it's 1 over n.
Okay, so.
So, but I mean, again, if, unless your taxation rate is over 100%, you can find a value that will work. But I mean, very few people pay more than 60% of tax these days. Want to meet them. Now, if everything worked out, then the exchange takes the third one, the gamma one that it didn't get the t value for, signs it, sends the result back to the customer, blinds it, hashes change. Now, this doesn't by itself quite fix everything. So the customer gets a change. We also need one more step, namely a threat. Suppose I'm having the scheme here. I can do this whole scheme and have T3. If I want to transfer money to somebody else, I just have T3 be picked by him. Right? He is supposed to illicitly receive money from me. So he picks T3. He can use my public key of my altcoin, doesn't matter, right? Do this computation, I never know this, I send this envelope, they're all well formed, right? Just I did not know the CNUs, right? And then of course he can get the final signed copy and unbind it. So the money was transferred to him. But what the exchange does, it says, if you give me C old, I will tell you T gamma, the public T that wasn't picked, to be disclosed to private one, and the signed envelope that I sent out earlier. Just hand them to you over again. Now, if the exchange gives out these two values, and I'm the owner of the original coin, if I have C old, we can apply the Diffie-Hellman the third way and say combine C old with T gamma, the public key here, compute the Diffie-Hellman. I can then derive the B and the C values, and I have also the coin. So basically, the link will allow me, as the owner of the old coin, to get the new coin, even if I didn't create it. Which reduces this to the sharing case. It's just like if I had copied the coin between the two of us, which is the case that we said was acceptable. Right? So even if he generated the whole thing, even if he just first knew the coin, well, that's a millisecond earlier, maybe, right? I will still get it. Okay, so to summarize, the exchange protocol can be used to convert old coins to new coins, possibly even change, and the new coins will be owned by the same entity. Now, if people trust each other, ultimately they're just one big entity, right? Like that. We can use this to give change. We can also use this to give refunds. If the merchant says, yes, you paid me, I deposited the money, but dear exchange, I want to give the money back to the customer. All the exchanges, it puts the money back onto the coin in the database. Says the merchant says, give it back. I, as the customer, do the refresh for the value I got back, and I'll have a new, freshly minted coin, unlinkable to the original one. And it's only possible that, that the original customer gets this coin, and I don't even know who the customer was. So I can give change to anonymous customers. The other thing we can do is this, is we can expire coins. So as the exchange provider, I do not want to keep a database forever, right? Unlike Bitcoin. So what I will do is I will say this denomination is valid for 2 years. And after 2 years, if you still have it in your wallet, please just go and exchange it for a new public-private coin, for new coins that are freshly signed as a new key that I'm having, right? And you can use this protocol to convert the keys of the coins that are going to expire into new coins. Right? And then, obviously, presumably most of the old coins have been spent, only a few new points of coins will be generated, but because most people don't withdraw things to not spend them ever, right? And then I can expire the old database and say, well, these coins now have, you know, nobody should have them anymore. And of course, the wallets will do this automatically. They will detect, oh, this is an old bill, you know, 5 years old, nobody has ever spent it. I should exchange it for a new one because it's about to expire. Right? Okay. So those are the three main uses of this problem. Questions about refresh?
Can you expand a little bit on the refund process? How does it work?
Basically, in the original contract, when the merchant was depositing the coin at the exchange, his public key was there visible for the exchange. And all he says, he signs a message saying, I want to give the customer money back from this deposit operation and specify how much, does not be the full amount. But he sends this to the exchange. Remember, the exchange with partial spending just deducts some amount of the coin value, and here just puts it back on the coin value. Right? And now we use the refresh protocol because now the coin has again some value, maybe it's full value, to transfer it from that public key to a new public key so it's not linkable to this initial operation that was refunded.
So the refresh has to be initiated by the original customer, right?
The refresh is always initiated by the wallet. Right? So when you buy something and there's change left, your wallet will automatically do this in the background. Right? And if you get a refund, of course the merchant has to tell the exchange, hey, the customer gets the money back, and somehow has to tell the consumer, hey, you're getting money back. Right? But
yeah,
that's small details.
Well, what's the, okay, two questions. First one is the whole coin is never demonetizable, right? And the second question is,
as I said, we can't expire.
I put it in a pen drive, I put it in my physical bank for 20 years, and then I come out of the pen drive and then go.
No, that's not the point. Is if the exchange can set an expiration date, because it may not want to keep state forever,
yeah,
and because it has to detect double spending, it has to keep all of the old transactions around until this denomination key expires, until the seal expires. Right.
So in my example where I put the money in the pen drive and put it in the physical bank locker.
Then if you do this past expiration date, it will be lost.
So,
but remember, this is for an economy. This is not savings and loans, right? if you want to do savings and loans, put this in your bank account, not in your wallet, right? This is for commerce. This is for economic activity, not for saving, right? So there's no real reason to put it on a thumb drive and put it in a vault, right? And if you say, but what if I have money left over and I never want to spend it? Well, just act like a merchant and pay yourself. Right? Then it goes back into your bank account. And then all you have to convince the tax authorities, well, it was an income, because look, I'm also the customer and you have that proof. Right? So it's not like there's no way to get it out of your wallet back into your bank account. But your wallet should effectively be live in a reasonable frequency corresponding to the expiration times for the coins.
And sorry, the second question was, what's the point of this, of the old coin, new coin? why does this feature exist?
Well, as I said, we need to be able to give change, so that if somebody has a denomination that's larger than what the transaction is, we need to be able to, you know, get change for the remaining value. We want to be able to give refunds, which we can do with this, and if coins do expire, we want to be able to move them over to.
But what is the purpose of expiration?
So the database at the exchange does not grow indefinitely, right? If I have to remember all coins that were ever spent at my provider for, you know, 100 billion years, that's going to be a lot of storage space, and I have to search this for every transaction, for every deposit. Now, it's a hash table lookup, so it's reasonably efficient, but not if it's a billion records.
That's a problem with Bitcoin, isn't it?
Yes, it's a problem because the blockchain will grow forever, right? And here, no data has to be kept forever, right? Once,
but I can put my Bitcoin in my safe forever. So it's like,
yes,
essentially I'm doing the,
yes,
pros and cons thing.
Yes, you could. Yeah. Well, this is not a system for savings and loans.
Yeah.
It's a different purpose. Right.
So the question is that all points of time in the transaction, whoever has information about your old coin has the most authority over your exchange, and that's the wallet, right?
The wallet is the only one who ever gets the private key of any coin.
Yes.
You don't give it to the merchant in a payment.
Is this wallet like stored centrally somewhere?
No, your wallet is on your computer.
On my
computer. It's your browser plugin, or it can be your app on your mobile phone if one exists at some point, or it can be a piece of hardware that you have, but it's you. It's completely decentralized. Everyone has their wallet, and nobody else needs to have any control over it, just like your physical wallet.
So should we at this point like just summarize the architecture a little bit? I mean, if this is really towards the close of your talk.
If this is the end of your talk,
then sorry. Okay, so yeah, so then maybe at some point we should summarize for those who came in late the entire system.
Well, since wallet was asked, so here's again something about the wallet. So you have your browser, and in our case, the wallet is implemented as a web extension, which runs the different contexts from the front page, right? Which means that it renders your contract. It's not the merchant who can control it. And only this extension has access to the wallet state, has access to your coins, right? Has access to your transaction history. All the websites cannot access it, assuming, let's say, the browser doesn't have a major security vulnerability in its own security model, right? So, and these two only communicate effectively via signals, JavaScript signals, the sending effectively, you know, here, payment initiation or whatever. Then between the browser and the web shop, you have here whatever HTTPS protocol, and the web shop itself consists of a front end, which is your usual, you know, build your shopping cart, deliver your goods, do your business logic, and when it has a contract, there's two interactions. First of all, it builds the contract, sends it to the backend, who will send back a signed version of it, so the signing process can happen in the backend, so the front end doesn't have access to signing keys. And similarly, when the payment comes in, it sends the payment to the backend talks to the exchange, comes back to the front, says successful or error, and then it's just passed through. So all of the crypto is actually in the Tata backend, which we provide, right? And so the front end is really just concerned with building a JavaScript JSON contract and passing through requests.
Likewise, in the previous slide, we were talking about the change, like from 500, we want 5 denominations into 100. So aren't we considering this whole system at a digital level? Why are we talking about the change? So are we going to get the real cash after using this wallet, or everything is going to be transferred only digitally?
Well, this is all being transferred digitally. I'm not sure.
So why are we talking about
the signature? The signature that is applied with RSA by the exchange. The digital signature of the exchange on a coin represents a particular value, particular denomination. It's worth one. This signature is worth 1 rupee or 5 rupees or 500 rupees, right? And we need different denominations, so I do not have this 1 cent problem. Okay.
Sorry, the way I understand is that the wallet is part of the computer, and not on.
Yes, all of this is on your computer.
Yeah.
Right, and all this is on the merchant side.
So suppose by some accident, my hard disk gets formatted.
Yes. It's similar to, suppose I drop my wallet into the, you know, toilet.
So it doesn't wallet. Right?
The nice thing is, you could make a backup, right?
Okay.
We haven't implemented this yet, but of course, you could make a, you know, backup of your wallet state in the cloud on a second computer, you know, but if you didn't make a backup,
cash, because
the backup does not duplicate the money.
No, it does not duplicate the money, because double spending will be detected, right? So, with your physical wallet, if you lose control over it, you lose your money. Here, well, there's two cases of losing control, right? If a hacker gets, you know, cracks your computer, you know, controls it completely, he can spend your money. And then it's gone, right? Whereas if you just drop your hard drive, if you have a backup, it's still okay.
The security of my wallet is not my headache.
Yes. So, one of the key things in the whole system is, if any of the three components, exchange, wallet, or customer, or merchant, if they get hacked, right, it's their problem, and nobody else gets harmed. If I as a customer, if my computer is under my control, I may lose the amount of money I have in my wallet. Nobody else can possibly lose anything, right? And how much I withdrew, that's my maximum risk. If I am the shop, and I get hacked, the most that can happen to me is that the money doesn't go to me, but goes to the hacker, right? It never goes to at the loss for the exchange or at the loss for the customers. I do not get any sensitive information about customers either, right? So again, I'm not going to lose, I have to go to the newspaper and say, oh, sorry, we lost 100 billion credit cards, and please replace all of the credit cards. Can't happen to me. Similarly, if the exchange provider is broken into, yes, you know, somebody might be able to mint coins illicitly, but then it's going to be the exchange who has to suffer the loss, and nobody else. Yeah.
So, in case that, let's say, we lose our money, just like normal currency, how normal digital currency works, is there any way to file a retracer with the exchange that okay, this was my wallet, this is my private key, I lost it, and
like, no, you have no proof to. The exchange does not know who was the right customer. All of the proof that this is real money was with your computer.
Don't you think that's a flaw in the design? Like,
no, if you withdraw cash from the ATM and burn it,
no,
try going to your bank and say, sorry, I burned my cash, the house burned down with all of my cash in it.
No, but
please, government, give me back my millions of rupees.
No,
you think they will do this?
No, but on the other hand,
no, no, that's a point.
If
you just want to inherit the flaws of existing physical wallets, then why would you go digital?
No, we don't. We don't
this
just
this
want
simulates the same flaw.
No.
Then
but we have
that,
yes, we share
money.
That same flaw that if I lose my digital wallet, it's the same as if I lose my physical wallet.
Yes.
You could speak.
Why would you emulate that flaw?
Because we don't quite have a choice, I think. we're doing slightly better because we can do backups. We're doing slightly better because we can do backups. Unlike cash, we do not have this possibility of bribes and tax evasion. Right? Unlike cash, we do not have problems with, you know, demonetization problems where we suddenly don't have change.
You just
right?
said that you have the demonetization
problems. No.
That's
I don't have a problem with issuing lots of coins, issuing, it's electronic, that's advantage. I do not have to worry about cash distribution. I do not have to worry about ATMs being out of cash.
Yeah.
You know,
okay.
As long as I don't have CPU power, I'm fine. Right? I don't need that much CPU power that would ever be an issue. Right? So many disadvantages of cash do go away. The one that if I withdraw cash and lose it, does not go away. If I withdraw digital cash, I can make backups. But if I lose it or lose all my backups or didn't make backups, I still have the same risks there. We don't solve all the problems in the world.
Yeah.
Just one question on the this thing: the database having to be cleared every 2 years. Supposing, for instance, it is required by law to be maintained for 5 years.
That's fine. Whatever.
That's fine. Then you can keep up.
Yeah, no, this is configuration parameters.
Okay, sure.
We have basically you configure how long you have to. We have three periods basically. We say
okay.
A coin can be issued for a certain period of time. That's how long I create new coins of this.
Right.
Then I have a period where it can be spent,
right.
Possibly you know months, years later.
Yeah.
And then I have an additional period where I preserve the database for settling legal disputes.
Yes, exactly.
Because it could be that a customer goes at the last minute and says, spend this, right? Something happens, there's a disagreement, and if I then delete everything, I have no more proof. So I have an additional period, it might be additional many years. I might hold this on cold storage, whatever, cheaper storage.
Right.
And then, again, it's the regulator in the end, and of course the business decisions of the exchange in compliance with the regulation says how long are these periods.
Okay.
Right? So the initial periods of how long to withdraw and how long it can be spent are largely business decisions by the exchange provider.
Okay.
Right? And then the how long to withdraw afterwards is kind of course, a legal requirement that comes into play as well. But the design allows us to, at some point, delete everything and still be correct.
Okay.
Is there a possibility of maintaining a buffer value in the wallet? Kind of. I don't want to withdraw every time from my bank.
That's usually what you should do. Yes. You do not ever want to withdraw the exact amount you're about to spend, because then I can correlate those two things.
No, but the point
you should
is,
withdraw, you know, one luck and then spend it over a month and withdraw another luck or something.
What I'm curious is whether I want to maintain, suppose, 10,000 rupees every time in my wallet. And I just want, if you know, it gets some threshold, I just authenticate a payment and it gets back into my wallet. I'm getting my point.
You authenticate a withdrawal operation.
Automatically. Is it a possibility? Is there a possibility of something? Because I don't
know. The problem there would be the authentication with the bank. If your bank allows some piece of software to automatically withdraw some amount from your bank account.
No, there needs an authentication from my end as well.
Yeah, well, then it's a question of usability thing. Do you really want your wallet to pop up and say, now please authenticate, or is this something what you do consciously? Right? So I would believe the usual case is that we treat this really like we treat a physical wallet.
Yeah.
We know, hey, we're running short on money. It's easy to find out, look at the balance. And then you go to the ATM with your physical wallet. And similarly, if you're running short on money, then you decide to go to your online banking site and withdraw more. Right? I mean, this is one of the contrast to cash. You go to a website, not half an hour in a queue. Right, so not all the problems of cash.
Yeah.
The way I understand it, a coin is backed to an actual balance.
Yes, the exchange holds the actual, but it's all actual currencies. The exchange holds kind of the banking money in escrow.
Yes. So now let's not go to demonetization, but let's say Japan had a case where the yen was suddenly divided by 100. Devaluation.
But this is just a pay. The game is numbers. Right? This is just how you shift the.
Yeah.
This has no real impact. And just
no, my point is, if your points are offline, how does the.
Exchanging to another currency,
that
person
does not.
Yeah.
But just change the definition of yen.
You change the definition of yen to yen 2 or something like that.
So you go to a physical exchange where you can exchange this currency for the.
No, okay.
So what's your take on Ethereum when you compare it with Ethereum and the Ether, the whole blockchain?
Well, Ethereum has many very different goals, right? We do not try to. Build distributed applications or decentralized applications with this. We do not try to have a computational engine. It does not do computations here, right? This is really just a payment system. Ethereum tries to do something completely different than payment systems in that regard. And of course, Ethereum does share the efficiency losses compared to the inefficiency of the blockchain, whereas this is way more efficient.
So
that thing remember, we talked about the transaction costs on the blockchain, which would also apply to Ethereum to some extent. Being dollars, here we're talking about transactions being 10,000-100,000 times less expensive, right? Because basically transactions put a couple of things into a database for persistence and check a couple of cryptographic signatures.
Because those guys have also come up with a Chrome plugin like MetaMask, and they also sort of transferring payments from one merchant to the other, and also the smart contract part that is.
Yeah, we don't do smart contracts in that respect because we don't have a virtual machine that executes arbitrary code. Right? It's just very different in that regard. Here, with competitors, our cash, try paying online with cash, doesn't work. Online with Nutella, you've seen, works very nicely. On the other hand, offline, Nutella will not work. Right? This is one of the key disadvantages, especially in rural areas of this country. Transaction costs, we believe, are cheaper than any of the others, but we are also much faster, much easier for taxation. The payer has better anonymity than any of the other systems. On the other hand, the payee, whoever receives money, has less anonymity, all except for credit cards, the same. Better security, everything is proper crypto. We do not have the conversion risks. And of course, just like these blockchain, most of them, we also do software.
And what about people had invested in the Bitcoin earlier and had made a lot of money when the value
goes
up?
I remember I had this slide on the pyramid scheme where you have an incentive to get more adapters because it reduces your investment. That doesn't happen here because you do not create a new currency.
You say one parameter, privacy.
What? This is the anonymity.
No, that's the.
Pay anonymity. We have that here. You have kind of the zero coin, but the technology is a bit more, let's say, cutting edge. And here, as I said, this is for me a problem because I do not want people to receive money that they can easily hide from taxation and controls.
One thing I was thinking, as you said, that the vendor cannot spend the Bitcoin without the coin without depositing it in his.
Remember, he doesn't really get the coin; he just gets a signature saying.
Yeah.
Exchange, please give this amount of the value of the coin to this vendor.
In a way, it makes it a little more inflexible than cash.
You don't have the transitivity of cash.
Yeah.
But we do this on purpose because the transitivity will allow people to evade taxes.
Yeah.
Will allow people to take bribes. Yeah. That's one of the key differences to cash where you kind of say...
But if I have got the money right now, I cannot pay it right now if there is no connectivity.
Yes. We don't.
Sorry, just one point about taxation. Is there a system where the exchange gives the data to the government or the government?
Certain data, when the exchange wants to transfer money to the merchant,
right.
It puts in a wire transfer subject saying
right.
Some hash.
Okay.
And then with this hash, anybody who can access this hash
right.
Can go to the exchange and say, what were the transactions and the transaction contract hashes. There's an API for that.
Okay.
This will be used by the merchant for its back office.
Okay.
It could be used by the government to say, hey, you got money here, let me find out. But you only get the hashes of the contracts that way. And then as the government, you can go to the merchant and say, reveal to me what the contract was that matches this hash code.
Okay.
Right? Okay. And assuming SHA-512 is secure,
yeah.
You better give the real contract, the same that the customer saw, but and then
and the exchange would be based in one country around the world or
no? I expect that there will be many exchanges in each currency domain.
Okay.
So for multiple reasons, first of all, you want to stick with the regulation of the respective currency, and that will be and with the culture that will be easier if you are in the country.
That's right.
Secondly, you get better network latency that way. Okay. Right? Me doing demos with a server in France. You know, in India, you would have a server in Delhi or Mumbai, or one in Delhi and one in Mumbai, whatever, right? And you get better latency, and of course, you are, you know, the government would want that anyway. You know, you don't want your payment service to be run in New York for India.
Yeah,
it makes no sense. It makes it less fault tolerant, higher latency, makes no sense. Now, of course, you could. You know, if you want to go, we have the new world currency, fine, go ahead, right? But the system itself, I want many providers.
So you have to go to an exchange every time, right? So then the quicker you get to the exchange, okay. The,
yes.
My question is, if I've given my wallet to him and we both have a copy of the same wallet, and I went to one exchange and he went to another exchange, the two exchanges.
No, both have to. If you have same exchange, same coin, same exchange.
Yeah. Oh,
the coin is tied to an exchange. The exchange that issued it. The exchange had the private key to sign it has to be the one that you go to.
Oh.
Can my wallet have coins signed by multiple exchanges?
Yes. Can have by multiple exchanges, multiple denominations, all no problem.
Is there an exchange to exchange link? How is that transaction?
No, the exchanges only talk to the existing banking system.
Okay.
Using the usual wire transfers between banks.
Can I take coin signed by one exchange and give it to the other exchange to convert it?
No.
So what if the one exchange is facing connectivity issues?
It shouldn't. It should be highly reliable and available, and if it's down, it will
what
be your payments will fail during that
period. High availability architecture.
Yeah, high availability architecture. If you need reliable network connectivity, if anybody is offline, then the payments for that provider will not be working during that time period.
So exchanges.
These days we are pretty good at building high availability systems if we really want to.
Exchanges are centralized.
No, they're not exactly centralized. The customer
then
picks an exchange. Every customer can pick whatever exchange is commonly accepted by the merchants. Right? So it could be that every bank that exists today runs an exchange, for example. It could be that there are a couple fewer exchanges. It could be that there are more exchanges in the end. It's a question of what is profitable to operate. You have to, of course, have this highly available architecture. You have to convince people that you're a good exchange operating at low fees, which means, of course, due to economies of scale, there will be some rather large exchanges. Right? But there can be many per currency, and certainly we have actually programmed it so that one exchange only does one currency. Because we figured, you know, the rest is just feature just it doesn't make it more complicated but adds no value.
Can you show some examples of business in this? As in, like the exchange, as you said, is a business, right?
Yes.
I can start my exchange and charge people for converting.
Transaction fees,
so
yes.
What can you give some examples on different businesses that can be modeled around this whole thing?
Well, first of all, as you just mentioned, if you're providing an exchange, right, you have to have this, you have your costs for providing a highly available structure, but you do can operate on fees for whatever you do. Right? Now, if you're a bank, you might say, I'm going to offer this to my customers, so, and only my customers, and do a tight integration, for example, with the banking webpage I showed, with their normal online banking, and I use it as a way to attract customers because they like fast and cheap and easy payments. Right? As a merchant, you would want to use this for the various reasons, earlier fast transactions, cheap transactions, and so on. Other business models, of course, will be that if we get this deployed widely, lots of merchants will want to have integration support. Right? So just doing software development support to integrate this with existing merchants, right? To develop wallets for new architectures as kind of, not necessarily best, it's maybe an additional expense, but to provide support for exchanges or in terms of running their systems, auditing their systems, helping them run it and support to merchants, those are also business models. So being an exchange, being an auditor and doing software support are business models.
And being the wallet as well?
But given that we are trying to provide free software wallets because we want the customers to trust their wallets, and given that most people are used to rather free apps for most things.
No, but if we give some value addition in that.
I don't know what you would do that couldn't be done in free software in the end. And again, I also think that we need to use free software. And this is the only thing that will come out of this. Anyway,
but you know, I think the extension of his question is actually this is the underlying software which gives you privacy in account relationship.
No, the protocol gives you the privacy.
Yeah.
Now, if you have a commercial implementation of everything, right, that implements it correctly, you know, you have certainly there are privacy guarantees from the protocol. And
no, what I meant is like Bitcoin and blockchain, right? There is that thing happening here?
No, there's no blockchain.
No, no, I mean not blockchain, but similar to that. There is something that you have built underneath this GNU payload, which could be used in multiple scenarios, not just in cash. That's the question.
Well, underneath some of this is the GNUnet, which is our replacement for the internet architecture. But I'm not going to talk about that today. Right, so this is based on, part of the code is 15 years old, but we're trying to reinvent the internet. But I'm focusing on something that we can deploy and use today, and you actually don't need to do any of the rest of GNUnet, you don't need to run any of it to do this. But yes, underneath there's lots of other technologies that feed into this.
Yeah.
From cryptographic libraries, web servers, and so on. But I'm not sure that was his question. Anyway, so what's going on right now? Well, we're still improving the wallet. You know, error after error handling, more features, more browsers supported. We're working on the exchange auditing process. We have written this tutorial for merchants in the tutorial for Webflow integration and are seeking feedback for that. If you want to see details about what the API looks like, you know, it's a RESTful API, what's each URL, what are the requests, what are the responses, what are the formats, it's all documented in detail here. How can you help overall? The current wallet only works for browsers and the web. We should do this also with mobile phones. I'm sure you appreciate that. So if you have time, please write an app for mobile phones and do the point of sale integration. That's kind of the next big step. Most existing web shops only support credit cards. So again, we need to have people who write payment plugins for Grothoff against all of these web shops out there. The current documentation is mostly in English. Here, this is the country of the most languages. So, you're welcome to join our team to help with translations of user interfaces, of documentation, of everything. The exchange needs to be a legal business to operate, as I've mentioned many times. You have income from transaction fees, so go ahead, find funding, create a startup in India. I would love to see this happen. Right? We're trying the same thing in Europe, but I'm not going to try the same thing in India. Right?
So what is the cost of setting up an exchange? Like, what are the regulations?
That depends on the country. I cannot answer that question for India. I can answer the question for the US. It's simply outrageous. And the question answer for the for Europe is still tricky to get there. For India, maybe the current Moody pain is just high enough to make this easy. I don't know. Okay. To conclude, what can we do? You can suffer from mass surveillance, enabled by credit card wallet that allows you to high fees. You can engage in arms races, blockchains, trying to prevent crime or go on a crime spree. You can continue to enjoy the benefits of cash, or you can help us establish a free software alternative balancing social goals of privacy and accountability. Thank you. Yes, we'll start with questions, and then we can do the demo again if somebody hasn't seen it.
Yes,
and
we can...
Delhi hasn't seen it yet.
Yeah. So, any questions, or should we do the demo again?
Start with questions.
Has the NSA shown any interest in this?
Not that I know of, but I'm sure they have shown some interest in me. For other reasons.
Have you picked the web payments API? The web payments API spent as being developed by the browsers?
We have people who are from our group participating in the World of Web Consortium Payment Interest Group. We have taken some inspiration from those discussions. But let's say some of the people on that work group are not terribly privacy friendly, and they are also not necessarily looking at free software solutions and looking at credit card payments. Maybe partially compatible. We're looking at trying to see that the contract formats are not too far apart if we can help it. For example, that you can say, I'm generating this contract in JSON, it will work for both of these APIs. So we're trying to keep the difference small, either by nudging them in the right direction or adapting where it's easy for us to adapt. But I cannot make any promises that will be the same because, of course, that's an ongoing process.
Could there be like a bridge of sorts? At the end, could there be an extension that?
It is premature to comment on anything that can be because there is no standard yet. And it's, all we can say is we are participating in the standardization process. But of course, I believe that we should just use this and forget about all the other things anyway.
Unlike the US, India is not a very country, it is not a country where people are too sensitive about their privacy. You know, they are, I mean, privacy is not
like the EU.
Yeah. So people are not, I mean, privacy is not something that can be marketed.
Yes.
It is something as a feature which is there in this whole thing. But people will not be, in India at least, they will not be attracted by the privacy part of it.
Well, what you should market is the usability, the transaction speed, the low cost, the fact that it's a commons, right? And you are a mender as opposed to you making yourself dependent on somebody else. So you have all of these other advantages that would appeal to many other groups, from governments to merchants to citizens. Now, some citizens will be open to the privacy argument, others may not care. But they, I believe there are enough advantages, as I listed under the value propositions, that there is appeal for all the groups, even those that, let's say, have a limited appreciation for privacy.
Can you summarize for citizens at least? I mean, which are the low-hanging fruits for citizens that, you know, which are clear winner for them?
So the five things in the beginning, right?
One is the speed. Speed, I think, is one thing.
I believe these are the main advantages for citizens. Now, of course, you might also add the ones from governments to that, because as a citizen in the government, you should have some shared interests.
Mm-hmm.
So here we do not list that no illegal activity takes place.
Yeah.
But do you like a crime spree as a citizen? No. But we still list this under an advantage for the government. Right? But so, as you see here, the privacy is one point. Right? The fact like Bitcoin is not a new currency, no fluctuation. The fact that it's free software, you don't get some, you know, unexpected features. The fact that it's, you know, secure, obviously no identity theft problems, no credit card theft problems, no, your credit card was rejected because of fraud detection going amok. These are clear advantages for citizens, or of course the usability that apply even if you don't have the privacy. The nice thing here is that the privacy gives us usability, gives us speed, gives us fast transactions. It also gives us accessibility because I can tailor the device to the user. Right. If the user is blind and can't do retina scan, right, or has an arm cut off, can't do a fingerprint, it doesn't matter. Whatever his device uses for him to authenticate against, right, I can adapt it to him. Right. Whereas the existing payment systems, there's a lot of things where I'm taking the devices off the merchant. I'm taking a very set system. Here, I can adapt it to the user and get accessibility from this. But all of these advantages are coming indirectly from privacy, are coming from the fact that I do not need authentication.
So adding
they
to that,
arise from it, but they are well, I have the others listed, right? You know, convenience and so on.
So adding to that, I mean, I think mobile phones today are becoming very personal, right? It has become a single point of failure for a lot of things, actually, right? So in that way, you know, having money in your phone device makes it more sensible, actually, that you already protect your phone for many reasons. So having money in that actually makes sense.
Yes.
Rather than having it anywhere else.
Yes,
it makes you more failure-prone. If your phone gets stolen, then you use
then, there are so many other things that are also failing with that. Mm-hmm. Your
but again, you can make backups and you can restore.
You rely on your single point of failure to be like have more data on your single point of failure.
But you can again, you can withdraw only a limited amount on your phone and you could make backups.
Is
but just like for your phone.
Is it tied to the device?
Hmm?
Is the wallet physically tied to the device?
No, it's that you can make backups.
It's just a
file. And you could, it's just a file, it's just a JSON database. Right. So this is. Remember, we do not want to have any device identifiers. We are privacy sensitive here. We never send anything identifying the user out in our protocol. Are we insane? No.
It's only locally.
What?
It's only locally. I mean, it's
yeah, it's only local on your computer. We do not, you know.
Yeah, but the wallet can still be tied to your computer, but that information you don't have to go to the exchange.
Yeah, well, what you might decide to do is you could say, I'm going to try to store the wallet state on some kind of TPM module to make it hard to access, but I don't actually believe that this gives you additional security in our case. Okay?
So basically, wallets can be easily get stolen by malware.
Yes. And then you learn that your system has been compromised,
right,
which also has some value for you.
Yeah.
You could also
we should all set up cloud wallets away from.
No, but again, if you have a compromised device and you withdraw from the cloud onto that device,
yeah,
it can still be accessed. You know, if I you know, compromise your device and I can access your cloud storage, I can delete your pictures in the cloud as well. So the cloud does not prevent you from being attacked. In fact, it just increases your attack surface.
This entire architecture relies a lot on personal accountability of your devices.
This is one of the key things here. We want personal accountability. Because one of the things that I do not want is saying, I did everything right and somebody else says this transaction was fraudulent. I did everything right and somebody else supports the transaction. I want to be able to say, if something goes wrong, it was me who did something wrong. And it should be me who suffers the consequences. A little bit of personal accountability is not a bad thing.
Which needs a lot of education.
Well, in this case, it doesn't need that much because the analogies to a physical wallet aren't striking.
Don't money is easy when it comes to physical money.
You do not need a lot of education to know don't lose your physical wallet. You don't need a lot of education to know don't lose your physical phone.
Don't browse sites where you can get malware infected. That's very difficult.
Well, there's one thing that is very, very difficult. Let me help you with one point here. One major source of the malware infestation is advertisements going across sites.
Correct.
And here, we offer a new way for websites to pay for their operations with micropayments, where I can efficiently pay a couple of cents this tether, which means the websites have a revenue source other than advertisement, namely direct payments, that they currently can't do because nobody pays for credit card to access a simple web article. And so if we reduce advertisement because an alternative way of payment is available, we might also reduce the number of entry points for malware. Little, you know, much aside.
Yeah, it could be possible.
I think I'll teach you how to encrypt your wallet.
Use your own separate key to encrypt your wallet and you retain the keys.
Sure, but the point is, it depends on how bad the infection is. Because at some point you want to decrypt the wallet, access it, and if the software still has control of your computer, boom. Right. So again, you have to be, you're responsible for keeping your own devices secure, be it as exchange, as merchant, or as customer.
I know an order by. Quick one though. I have a wallet, and I can only spend on one exchange, right?
No, you spend at any merchant, but the merchants have to allow that this exchange to be.
So with that, so I am limited to spending my money, or the merchant is limited to spending money on only the one exchange?
No. The, you, as a customer, withdrew at a particular exchange.
Yeah.
At a fee structure you liked.
Yeah.
And the merchant can only say, this is an exchange I do not trust. Say, you know, obviously, I could make up one that isn't audited by the government, and why should the exchange trust that, you know, random black guy to be correct? Okay. So, the merchant would typically say, I accept the following auditors. You know, the Bank of India has to say, this is okay. Then I'm happy to do transactions.
Okay, let's say I withdraw the money. Now, every merchant will say, I don't like that exchange anymore.
Then you send it back to yourself.
Send it back to myself through a different exchange?
No, through the same exchange. I mean, you're
paying the exchange doesn't exist anymore. It's gone.
Well, that's
now
the point.
You're being partial accountability.
No,
it wasn't my fault that the exchange went out.
If there's a bankruptcy protocol where if an exchange goes bankrupt in a normal process, it will tell the wallets and the wallets effectively send the money back to your bank account. Now, if the exchange is not properly audited and can really just literally just disappear, you lose your money, right? But that's just like, you know, if HSBC decided tomorrow, we're gone, and they disappear into nowhere, you know, that's why you want the government to regulate it, because HSBC will not disappear
tomorrow. So my point is, that's a big flaw in your personal accountability argument. When I'm sitting with my wallet, and my exchange goes down, will you
know? No, the system relies, the bank will not trust the exchange in the first place if the exchange is not licensed.
Yeah, exchange is fully licensed and everything. It's like perfectly valid. Next day,
but what is this year? This component of the auditor auditing the exchange.
But you're relying on the government
to
valid to sign.
Yes, just like you rely on the government every day that your bank is not going to disappear tomorrow. It's exactly the same.
The difference is today these exchanges with cash are the Reserve Bank of India, or the European Central Bank, or the Federal Reserve, which can bring
No.
Exchange is a normal proper bank.
No.
It's a payment service provider.
Your cash note says the governor of the RBI promises to pay you the money.
This is not for cash, by the way. But if you have your money at HSBC or at yesterday,
but you are saying
India.
That it's in my wallet. So you're saying that once it's with me, it's cash.
Yes.
But it's still backed.
It's backed
by the respective issue.
So instead of having RBI cash, you will have HSBC cash, ICICI cash.
Which makes it extremely, RBI cash is God cash because... Okay, bad example.
It was God cash.
Bad example. Federal Reserve cash is God cash because they can print cash. HSBC cannot print cash.
It's a policy.
It's a huge.
They have print cash.
The point is,
yeah.
The point is, these payment service providers will be allowed by the government and licensed by the government and audited by the government to issue these digital coins. Right? And this exists already. If you take prepaid credit cards, for example, you have a private bank that issues a prepaid credit card and it guarantees to everybody, whenever somebody swipes, we will pay them. Right? That's exactly the analog here. And again, you trust these systems because the government says, we are checking on the banks. We guarantee you that they will not disappear tomorrow and take away your money. And if they do this, insurance
system... I would take the word of a reserve bank. I would not take the word of any private bank, however much...
You are depositing your money there, right?
Okay, maybe I'll take this offline.
But the point is... I believe most of us do trust. Most of us do trust these various entities already, if they are sufficiently regulated. And if you do not, nobody says that this could not be run by the government. It could be that the government runs the exchange in some cases. And it will limit competition, it might introduce usual inefficiencies of government, it might increase trust by people in some cases, in some cases it might decrease trust if it's the Indian government. Right? It really depends. Right? The architecture allows there to be many banks, and you can specify which auditors you trust, you can specify I trust only these exchanges, explicitly as a customer. Right? But in general, I believe the answer is going to be there's going to be multiple auditors, some government appointed, maybe some foundations, and they're going to say, we audit these people, and then you as a customer can say, I trust these auditors, I trust these providers, and then if your trust is misplaced, you lose your money.
So it's what you said, right? The exchange goes down.
The Indian government does not allow a bank to fold. They ask them to merge, and you get up to 1 lakh of your fixed deposit.
No, I don't think that's the point. I think one of the things that you pointed out, Christian, was in the points of failure in Dalar, right? If I lose my wallet, it's my fault.
Yes.
Right? But here, there's an extension argument as well, right? Which is, if my trust in an exchange is misplaced, then also I lose my money.
Right.
That's also
right?
Your fault.
He may not have elected the current government, right? And everybody said, we trust this government to audit our banks and keep them safe. And if then the Lehman Brothers hits, you can't say, I was in the opposition, and the government didn't prevent Lehman Brothers, and I lost my money. But in the end, the technology at least tries its best to protect
the credibility of a lot of auditors and a lot of people who back this will also go down if something like this happens.
Yes, but the point is, this is not a problem that is unique to this.
You guys are saying all this after the year 2008. There is no zero accountability. I mean, 2000, it happened. We were all there when it happened.
Or hopefully, we were all there.
This is we do not solve that problem. If the governments are unable to ensure that the payment service providers remain liquid, it's a problem. However, we improve in one respect. Currently, banks conflate three domains. They have investment, they have savings and loans, and they have currency supply liquidity, supporting liquidity. Right? These are three domains. And we have seen the investment crash the other two in 2008. Right? And here, also architecturally, we have the bank, that's for our savings and loans. We have the exchange, that is really just facilitating commerce. And investment could be a very third thing. And we could keep these three functions that were fused by relaxations of laws in the US separate and thereby also contain failures into the respective domain. And the nice thing is here by the exchange, you have a clear business model, right? Where you can clearly show our fee structure allows us to make more profit than our expenses are. And you can verify as the auditor that it operates correctly by checking the digital signatures on all of the transactions. So the risk of those providers going bankrupt compared to an investment bank that speculates on whatever the markets might do tomorrow is very, very small. And so by separating savings and loans where whoever gave you loan might default.
So
investment is highly speculative and currency supply, you can reduce the risk for people who deal with currency. And we do not have, like what happened in Greece, where savings and loans, first investment, impacting savings and loans, now savings and loans, then impacting currency supply. Those kind of cascades would not happen if we separate these institutions clearly.
But at least architecturally we do.
The argument is sound, right? I don't think anyone will argue that argument, at least in this room. But people have been crying foul about breaking up large banks in the US for like exactly the along the lines that you're talking about.
I can't solve the political problems.
Sure, exactly. So actually solved
that problem. Like in the United States, what they do with these exchanges is, you know, over the counter transactions, you actually have a trade regulated body that's effectively acting as a central exchange. And that is regulated by the government and is also effectively trustworthy.
So that's again the point. Do you trust the government regulation? Is it effective? Right.
No. In this case, they have guards against the government. Essentially, there's sort of a...
Who will guard the guards?
But here's the honest thing. In our architecture... this could be the government. But who says you only have to have one auditor? I could have a government auditor, like a central bank, right? But I could also have a foundation or a private hacker club. And I, as a customer, can also say, I only trust the hacker club, right? And the merchant might say, I only trust the government, right? And some people might say, I only trust this foundation. And all the auditor does is the exchange says, here's my database with all of the transaction records that I've taken. And it goes over them, totals things up, checks the wire transaction, says, yeah, matches. Signatures check out. Right? So it's not a very expensive process, and you could have multiple auditors. Right? I would not say you can have anybody be an auditor, like all the citizens, because the database is going to be a bit big to just replicate it everywhere. Right? That then gets expensive. But you can have multiple auditors at a reasonable cost, and therefore put even a check on, does the government do a good job? Because if the government fails to detect some fraud, and somebody else does, they can raise the alarm and would have the proof that there was something going on.
Today, the Australian government has declared that their tax department lost some data.
Yes.
So, he says he's not solving the political problem at all. So he's trusting in the current political architecture.
Well, you have to, of course, make sure that you have good backups as the exchange, that you have reliable 24/7 operations. But these are problems we can and know how to solve. Right? And yes, you might only get 6-9 reliability, but you know, other systems also sometimes fail. Right? It just has to work almost all the time. Right? And the cases where things can go wrong are at least reasonably clearly understood and reasonably limited.
So should we do the demo again if there are no more pressing questions? And then we can always have the conversation.
Sure. You want to stop the recording? That might also enable some people to ask questions.